come from the net. Blogs, websites, podcasts, to this place, the Mainframe Chronicle.
Our format, podcasters, to analyze and discuss, to discuss the shows we love.
Their strengths and flaws.
We discuss them until our jaws ache.
Software pirates. Oh, this is bad. This is very bad.
Megabyte hit a delete command in the mask, just like you said. Only you didn't know because I should have copied and pasted the truth from the start.
I am the Crimson Bino.
Well, get to work, you two. I don't keep you around for your brains now, do I?
No, sir, not our brains. Absolutely not.
Ever heard of a door?
Ever heard of a frisket?
So many moods. So little time.
This is gonna take millions and millions of nanoseconds. This might even take one whole second.
Dot, can you read me? Dot!
Not good. This is not good.
It's an infinite data elusive loop.
What's that mean?
Moons run like you've never run before!
Be careful, young Enzo. Remember that anything worthwhile takes time.
I couldn't figure out how to beat that user. I must be basic.
Aye, sir! Aye, aye!
They say the listener lives outside the net.
And listens to podcasts.
No one knows for sure.
But we intend to find out. Mainframe Chronicle.
Hello and welcome to Mainframe Chronicle Podcast. I'm Daniel Janes.
And I'm Joey Morris.
And today we are going to be finishing out season one of ReBoot. The four episodes we're covering today are The Great Brain Robbery, Talent Night, and Identity Crisis Parts 1 and 2. So, Joey, why don't you take it away with The Great Brain Robbery?
I don't know about you, Dan, but I am pretty excited about some of these episodes today.
Agent 6.
Roger, Mothership. The monkeys are restless, and my dog has fleas. Over.
What? What are you talking about?
They're on their way, sir.
Well, we're going to start with The Great Brain Robbery. Its original air date was December 31st, 1994. And the description of the episode is, on orders of Megabyte, Hack, Slash, and Mercenary Mouse, shrink via a compression field and enter Enzo's brain with evil intentions. So, Dan, what did you think of this episode?
I found it pretty interesting. Most interesting part is that this episode was more of a parody of the 1966 film Fantastic Voyage, where they shrink down and enter some guy's brain. And I found that pretty interesting that, you know, back in 66 they were doing this in live action, and now they're doing it with computer animation, and it worked pretty well.
Yeah, I always enjoy these kind of episodes. Every other show has done something like this. I know there's a Star Trek episode where they shrink really small and shoot photon torpedoes at everybody and somehow doesn't kill them. And even like the Magic School Bus does it. It's always kind of interesting to see the different. It's the same story, but I always like to see the different shows put their own twist on it.
Yeah, totally. It's not a overly fantastic episode for me. I did enjoy it. There's a lot of good parts to it, but overall, it's pretty average, I think.
I honestly, I know that Mouse is such an amazing character later on that I kind of wish that her intro episode had a little bit more lasting impression on you. You know yeah, what I mean? Like something totally. Maybe a little bit more intricate to the story. I didn't mind it, but just as the fact that Mouse, for crying out loud, shows up here and it's just kind of like, didn't mesh with that.
Yeah, totally. I feel like her character just kind of suffers from this episode. There's not a whole lot of her being awesome in it, which is fine. Oh. I mean, it's not really an episode about her. It's right. more introducing her.
What did you think of Mouse overall?
Like I said, like you said, she gets awesome later on in the series, but this episode was just kind of like, oh, that's Mouse. We saw her symbol in the Crimson Binome on the pirate ship, but now, like, we actually see who she is, and we see that she and Bob have a past, and that she tried to hack the central computer, but Bob stopped her.
I think that's cool.
Yeah, she doesn't do a whole lot that's impressive in this episode.
She makes Dot jealous. That's pretty impressive.
Well, yeah, but that's always a thing.
That's true. One thing that's pretty small, but I was really impressed with the first screenshot of the city. You know, we kind of zoom through the city a little bit. You know, when you think about how the show has to be created, they have to, you know, create every building, and they've got to, you know, use computer programs. They spent 8 seconds just kind of zooming through the city. It was a really nice touch, and you got to know how much work went into something so simple and not even really part of the story. So I just wanted to give kudos to the probably the art director on that one.
Yeah, the great example of their fantastic for the time animation. Nowadays it's, you know, pretty much obsolete, you know, that's to be expected with technology and 17 years time.
Absolutely. I thought it was also pretty stupid how Megabyte was all like, ooh, I probably shouldn't have paid her in advance. Do you ever pay mercenaries in advance? I mean, whoever does that? I thought he was supposed to be intelligent.
You have to pay him half up front and then half at the end. Otherwise, that's the only way for it to work.
So much for being a mega villain, I tell you what.
Yeah. I liked how much this episode showed how bad it is for Megabyte to work with his minions.
Yes. You know?
He'd like send him out to do something, and he'd be like, one of the minions was like, the monkeys are restless and my dog has fleas. Megabyte just was like, what the hell does that mean? What are you talking about?
Talking about a rotten jelly sandwich or something at one point, you know, yeah. Like their own little language that doesn't make sense to Megabyte. And you know, about Hack and Slash too, as one of his minions, you know, if they weren't so stupid, they'd be pretty deadly. I mean, look what they were able to do in this episode. Fly around and shoot cannons out of their arm, for crying out loud.
Yeah. Good stuff. Good stuff. So on top of Mouse, we also get the first appearance of Sergeant Smiley,
yes.
Who is the guy who's supposed to inject the shrunken Mouse and Hack and Slash into Bob's drink so that they can get into his brain. But the drink goes to Enzo, and, you know, just more incompetence on the side of Megabyte's henchmen.
No, absolutely. I mean, as cool as Megabyte is as a villain himself, you know, it has to fall flat somewhere, and it falls flat with his minions because they're all stupid and ridiculous. Because Megabyte himself is a very capable, intelligent guy, and that has to be the his folly is that he just has stupid people working for him.
Yeah, it reminds me of the evil overlord list of things to not do.
Yeah, is get stupid minions.
Yeah, you definitely don't want stupid minions. Yeah. I mean, it's right up there with don't give away your master plan while hero is supposedly tied up and,
right,
you know, have their deaths actually happen instead of just set out an elaborate trap that'll eventually kill them.
And of course, never trust a sexy woman ever.
Right.
So, because they're always backstabbers.
Exactly.
But there was a couple little things that I wanted to add. And I've seen this the last couple episodes, and it just kind of goes again to the creators and how they have to do, you know, some special things to create a character in this universe. Because, I mean, they're creating everything from the ground up. When you see Megabyte and he gets angry, you always see his fist clench, you know. And that's just one of those, I think, subliminal things that they're just trying to add to his upsettedness, because you can't really show a whole lot of emotion with the amount of CGI that they have at this time. So, you know, they got to kind of go around it a little bit. And did you notice that? I don't know why I even think this is so funny, but when Bob and Mouse were exiting the body and they get ready to move and they're going to move fast, the screen shots, there's like two screenshots of the seatbelts connecting on Mouse and Bob, like, you know, they're all going to die, but let's make sure that they're safe and have their seatbelts on.
Nice. Good subtle subliminal messaging for children.
Yeah. Exactly. See, there's so much that this show does right.
No wonder I always wear my seatbelt. It's because of ReBoot.
Thank you all these years later.
That's awesome.
Do you have
awesome.
Any phrases that you might want to kind of tout as your favorites of this episode?
There were actually quite a few that were pretty good. Like I said, the monkeys are restless and my dog has fleas. Just all of those random code words that nobody understands.
Yes.
We're pretty good. Fong says, there was an old file my parents used to tell me, and it involved a sprite who went a little crazy, and he had a long beard. It's like, I really want to know what he's talking about, like if that's a reference to some fairy tale or something, but I couldn't think of anything.
I couldn't either.
That at one point, Enzo starts singing I'm a Little Source Code to the tune of I'm a Little Teapot. That one's pretty awesome.
Here is my input, here is my out. <That's great.
laughs> Good stuff. Yeah, that's about it for quotes. I did notice that some interesting things, like when they're at Al's diner and, you know, he orders the drink and it comes right up, the bartender's shocked. He's just like, what? Al's working fast today.
Yes.
At Al's slow food diner. Yeah. Good stuff. Towards the end, Mouse says something along the lines of, you were always such an exciting date to Bob. And Bob's face is just pure shock. It's just like, what? It was a date? And I just thought it was a very, very awesome animation moment.
It was, and because it is hard to show that emotion, I think, and they're nailing it, and they get better and better as the show goes on. But, you know, and a lot of it comes from the voice acting, too. I mean, not in that specific moment, because it was mostly visual, but you can feel, like, the warmth and realistic. I don't know. They really bring the characters to life. I think all the voice actors are very good.
I totally agree. And I love at the very, very end, Enzo sneezes and the enormous ship pops out. It's just a great comedy moment.
Sure. It works out just perfectly.
Yep. Some references. The title is clearly a reference to the Great Train Robbery, which I recently found out was an actual event in like the 1960s that happened, but
yeah.
The one I know of is the movie from like 1903 that is one of the forerunners of modern storytelling.
Yeah, I just originally thought that that's what this was. The Great Train Robbery was the Great Train Robbery, and I did a little research, and they were talking that it was an actual robbery on the train in the 60s, which I had no idea about.
Yeah.
I thought it was just a 1903 movie.
Yeah, I'm going to assume that it was more for the movie than the actual event, because why would it reference an actual event when it has absolutely nothing to do with a great train robbery.
Exactly.
Whereas if it's just a title reference, that is a lot less committed to anything.
It seems more up Reboot's alley anyway.
Yeah.
I'm a little source code short and stout. This is my input, this is my out. This is too weird.
Yeah, I think overall is good. Dan, would you like to rate this episode?
Yeah, like I said, it's not a fantastic episode, but by no means is it a bad episode. So I'd go with an average 7 neural matrix scramblers.
I probably would have given this episode a 5, but just because it's the first showing of Mouse, I'm going to give it a 7 as well. So I'm going to give it 7 awkward mouse winks. Because she kept winking. It just didn't work.
Awesome.
Give it up for Captain Quirk. Packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the Earth so much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time.
So Dan, would you like to move on to the second episode we're talking about today, which is the 11th episode, named Talent Night?
I would love to. Talent Night was originally aired on January 7th, 1995. It was written by Lane Reichert, and the story was Gavin Blair, Phil Mitchell, and Ian Pearson. In this episode, Bob keeps Enzo busy as Dot works on setting up a surprise talent show for him. And eventually they get to the talent show, and hilarity ensues. So, Joey, your thoughts on this episode?
There are often times when a show kind of goes off the beaten path of their normal story type show. You know, there's no episode, I should say, and it fails. However, this is the rare occurrence when they completely throw the normal how they run this show out the window, try something completely different, and it's amazing. Everything they touched in this episode was gold.
Yeah, I mean, I really wanted to dislike this episode, but there's just so much comedy and so well done. It's so well done, and the references are spot on that it works too well to be disliked.
I know, I loved it. I mean, and even after watching it, and I thought that I liked it at a certain amount, then you did a little bit more research and found out things that I missed, and it liked it even more. So I love this episode.
Yeah. It's Enzo's first birthday, which I thought was pretty interesting.
Yeah.
That he's only one. But then it got me thinking, like, is that in computer time? Like, because that would make sense, and that would be a really long time. Or is it, like, in normal time? But I don't know. The timing is all sorts of weird in this show.
I think it probably has to go with computer time, because, I mean, what is the life of a computer? 5 or 6 years?
Yeah.
You know, at the most. So 1 year old is a milestone.
That's true. So, yeah, throughout this episode, we see a bunch of acts as Dot and Emma C are trying to gather the acts for the talent show, and Emma C, who is the program censor, keeps negating the ones that Dot likes, which is a clear statement as to the absurd restrictions that they had for this show on ABC.
I wonder what ABC, you know, censored out that never got to the drawing board. Like, I'm just curious as to what, you know, like Gavin Blair and everybody wanted so much that ABC was being ridiculous and backing them down. I'm just curious.
Yeah, it would be interesting to see all the ideas that didn't make it into the show. Yeah.
Why don't we just start with our favorite acts? There's so many of them. But
there are so many of them. Most notable ones to me were the Johnny O'Binome, who was the pun master, or prince of puns, and he strings off a list of binary numbers, zeros and ones, and it translates to, "Take my wife, please."
As soon as I heard this, I knew you would love it because, you know, a little factoid, one of the first things that Dan ever said to me was that he will go out of his way for a mediocre pun.
That's true.
And that is held true for the entire time that I've known him. So as soon as they said the Prince of Puns, I'm like, this is going to be good.
So good.
What was another one?
I had several. They had the Dyers, Sal and Harv, and that was a homage to, as we mentioned before, the Money for Nothing video for the Dire Straits that Mainframe Entertainment did in 1985.
Yep. I think my favorite one, which is probably no surprise, was the Captain William Shatner impersonation. Have you ever seen that, Dan?
I've not seen that one specifically, but I've heard some of his other stuff.
Yeah, well, you know, William Shatner comes out, I guess I probably should have done, you know, if I was a good podcaster, I would have looked this up, in the late 70s, like a spoken word album, you know, where he would just speak through songs as opposed to singing them. And one of the ones that was the most famous was him singing Rocket Man by Elton John. And it is phenomenal. It's on YouTube. You check it out because it's so cheesy and so hammy, but it's stood the test of time. Like, people still talk about it today, you know? So, and then they had a Captain Quirk as opposed to Captain Kirk, do it with a bad toupee. And I just loved it. I mean, it was nothing but fantasticness.
Yeah. That one was very, very well done. I enjoyed that very much. Some other good ones were, the Small Town Binomes, who were a parody of the Village People, and they did a song called BSNP instead of YNCA. And BSNP stands for Broadcast Standards and Practices, another homage to the censorship of television.
I really think if you try and tell someone that there's a show that by itself works fantastically, but somehow combines references to the Village People and Captain Kirk and broadcast rules and standards and practices, wouldn't be possible. And then you have Reboot and it works amazingly.
Yeah. And what would any talent show episode be without an Elvis impersonator?
Oh, a fat Elvis impersonator. Yeah. Mind you. So this was what, late? Or when did he die? Do you know?
He died in 1977, I believe.
Yeah, so it would be like middle to late 70s when he was rather large, but, you know, and it worked out that way. You know, his hair was going away and all of that kind of stuff. But there were, and they even said, you know, Elvis has left the building, but they said it for Megabyte, which we'll get to because I think that's the best part of the whole episode. But you had people doing moonwalking. You know, obviously that's an homage to Michael Jackson.
Yeah, the guy who moonwalks is one of Megabyte's minions who gets caught on stage. And then all the other minions, you know, scatter. And he's just like, what do I do? What do I do? Breakdance. And then Dot and MSC are like, breakdancing? Oh, man.
Can I just take a moment to say how awesome Megabyte spies are with all their 1950s spy gear?
Yes. Fantastic. And they had more of the random code words and stuff that Megabyte didn't understand. It was good times.
It's an old joke, but it just keeps giving.
Yeah.
Did you see Toot Guy in the audience?
Yeah.
I got super excited.
Toot Guy was in the audience. He was front row. And he was also on the energy slide when he's like right in front of Enzo before Bob throws him down the slide.
Yes, he was. I forgot about that.
Love Toot Guy.
I do too. He's like my favorite.
Yeah. It's good stuff.
Did you see when they're coming in backstage, there's a lot of stuff going on back there, but there was a giant red robot. Does he mean anything to you? Did you recognize him?
I feel like he was a reference to something, but I couldn't figure out what.
It took me a second, too, because they kind of lingered on him for a minute, and I was just like, right. What is going on? And I really had to think about it. The YTV, which is where this first aired in Canada, that's their mascot. And it goes with the YTV character. And I had to think about it because it's just from the waist up. But I just love that little homage to YTV, for crying out loud.
That makes sense. And I'm glad you picked up on that because I never would have known.
Exactly. But you ever watch The Forbidden Planet? I had never heard of this movie before.
No, I have not.
There was they were talking at the water cooler, there was a phrase, "Certainly, sir, would 64 gallons be sufficient?" which is apparently a direct quote of Robbie the Robot from The Forbidden Planet. I had just never read that before, so I thought you would have.
Yeah, it's an older movie, kind of out of my frame of reference, but probably worth watching.
I don't know if there's anything out of your frame of reference. You have quite a bit out of everything, so...
Pretty much anything before 1960, chances are I haven't seen it, unless it's film noir.
Fair enough. Did you know this was a new Enzo?
I did not until I read it.
Yeah, I didn't either. I did not catch up on the difference in the voice at all.
No, but I did a good job, so congratulations, I guess.
What did you think of Dot's song?
I felt that it was a little weird that she was singing that sensually towards Enzo at first. Once it got to Bob, it was reminiscent of Marilyn Monroe and JFK.
Yeah.
But the song itself reminded me of, you know, several musical songs where, you know, the girl's just trying to seduce the guy.
Or the president, you know, whatever.
Or the president.
I thought it was really weird, too. At first, I was really excited because I like when characters kind of go out of their element a little bit and do something different like that. And then it got really weird. And then it moved over to Bob, and it was made a little bit more sense. But I don't know. That was actually Kathleen Barr. She could actually sing.
Good.
So that was cool.
Yeah. Turn your phone off.
Mine?
Yeah, I can hear it.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. I threw it away. Cool. I guess we could, unless you have anything else, we can get to Megabyte's appearance.
Good, yeah. That's all I have left is Megabyte being awesome.
Because I guess there's a little bit of foreshadowing in the beginning when Megabyte finds out that there's going to be this big shindig. He doesn't exactly know why, and he's just upset because he's not invited to this party. And so they talk about, did you write down the code? I didn't write down the code.
Which code?
The code that he's like, you know, 216 or something, you know, like, and they were like, 216?
Oh, no.
I don't remember what it was, but they're all frightened about it. We don't know what it is until the last half, and I'll let you take a lead on this one, Dan, because I feel like you'll tell it better than I would.
So, yeah, Megabyte shows up, the stage goes dark, a bunch of huge speakers drop in, and then we see Megabyte popping out of a giant metal coffin, which is a clear reference to Iron Maiden, because they, you know, did that kind of stuff, which was pretty ridiculous.
I almost fell out of my chair when this happened. Like, I was like, what is going on right now?
Yeah, and then... You know, he turns his amp up to 11 because his amps go to 11, even though he could just make 10 louder, but his amps go to 11, which is clearly a reference to This Is Spinal Tap and the mockumentary that it is, the glorious, glorious film. And then the last big reference from Megabyte and his band is the Hack and Slash are the drummers, and they have a rotating drum set which actually exists from Tommy Lee of Motley Crue actually used those a couple times in live shows, which is crazy.
I wish Have you ever saw them live? I could only imagine how amazing that would be.
No, but I'm planning on going to look up some videos later on YouTube. So yeah, good stuff.
And then, of course, Bob comes up and decides to do a dueling guitar war with Megabyte. And I just, while it's happening, I'm pretty sure my draw was actually dropped.
Nice.
Because they have this amazing guitar riffs, and then Megabyte's just like, I've always wanted to do that, and then drops the guitar off to Enzo for his birthday and just walks away.
Yep. And you're just like, oh, Megabyte's kind of cool.
I loved it. It was perfect in every way, shape, or form.
Did you notice what Bob tells Glitch when he turns it into a guitar?
Yeah, he says BFG, but I didn't know what that meant.
It's a reference to the BFG 9000 from one of the original first-person shooters, Doom, which stands for Big Freaking Gun, but not freaking.
Of course.
And so, you know, it stands for Big Freaking Guitar in Reboot, which, you know, subtle but effective and definitely quite fun.
Now, who did you think won on pure guitar style?
To be honest, I'd have to go back and watch it again because I was so blown away by all the magnificent references. But probably Megabyte.
I was going to say Megabyte. Now, I'm not a guitarist and I'm not a connoisseur, so I wouldn't know any real lingo or language of what's going on. But I just thought Megabyte blew it out of the water.
Yeah. Yeah, he was definitely awesome. And then he drives off in the ginormous limo, and they say, Megabyte has left the building.
Oh my gosh, that's so awesome. And there's just so many references. This entire episode is really references.
Right, which is most of the show's or episode's power, I think.
I agree.
Because story-wise, it's pretty boring and kind of dumb, but because there's so many references, it's just fantastic.
And then in later seasons, they actually become less episodic, so the stories kind of develop a little more and they become better stories, so the show only can get better.
Right. Exactly.
And now, playing their smash debut hit, BS&P, oh, you love it, it's the Small Town Binomes!
So, Joey, what would you rate this one?
Oh, man, I want to give this a 10 so bad. But since it's not actually, like, relevant to plot or the series itself, I probably shouldn't. So I'm going to give it 9 toupees.
Nice. Yeah, like I said, it's not very good as far as story or action, really. But the references and Megabyte's guitar solo knock it up to 7 binary puns for me.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Alrighty, so on to Identity Crisis Part 1.
Come on, Enzo, you gotta take games seriously. Who knows? One day, you might end up in the Funhouse.
There's no such thing as a Funhouse. That's just a stupid story.
I don't like the look of this. The Funhouse!
Joey, why don't you take this one?
This is going to be the beginning of our, I guess, our first two-parter and our first non-episodic episode, so it's pretty exciting. Oh, shit. Sorry. The story was written by The episode was written by Jono Howard and the story by Gavin Blear, Phil Mitchell, and Ian Piercing. The original air date was January 14th, 1995. The episode starts with Dot inspiring the binomes of Sector 1000 to rebel against Megabyte, only to begin to doubt her own abilities. So, Dan, what did you think of this episode?
I enjoyed it. It wasn't great because it was clearly a setup for the next part. Why don't you give us your quick thoughts and then we'll go into that and discuss them as a whole.
Yeah, no, I agree. I there's not a whole lot that went down in the first part that's not done better in the second part. So we've decided that we're going to talk about this all together, and Dan's going to read about Identity Crisis Part 2 to you, and then we'll just throw at it all together.
Yeah, this one aired January 21st, 1995, and written by Jono Howard as well. And the story was also by Gavin Blear, Phil Mitchell, and Ian Pearson. And basically, Bob and Dot go into the funhouse, but Bob gets caught, and Dot is so distraught about failing that Fong, you know, shows her what would happen if she just gave up. And this gives her the strength and the courage to go through and beat the game. And then eventually they save all the binomes that Megabyte was going to corrupt.
Right. And I guess it kind of alluded to all of Mainframe, actually. Yeah, I mean, it started with Sector, but, you know, by Dot doubting her own abilities, this alternate reality, she started the beginning of the fall of the entire Mainframe.
Right. Now, this is a story trope that has been used over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. But I still think they pulled it off and did it well and did it in, you know, a fairly new way, if only in that it's Reboot's version of it.
No, exactly. And it's just like we were talking earlier with the Great Brain Robbery. It's the same story, you know, but each different show has to do a little differently, and nobody else does it like Reboot. So I'm okay to watch this old type, what do you say, story trope, and bring it into a new light in this new fantastic way that Reboot does it.
Yeah. The part one had a really good setup and payoff moment with the mention of the funhouse at the beginning.
Yes. Where Enzo calls it a myth.
Yeah. It's like this daunting thing that supposedly doesn't exist and was just to scare the younger sprites and whatnot. And then, you know, it shows up at the end and Bob and Dot are stuck in the funhouse. And I really enjoyed that.
I love the setup. What did you think of the funhouse itself?
I kind of enjoyed it. I wish we had seen more of it. But for the sake of the story, I'm actually glad we didn't, because it would have just detracted from the story of Dot and her, you know, confidence in herself,
which was the entire point behind the two episodes. You're right. I did feel a little cheated, only because you can do so much with creepy clowns and you can do so much with a scary funhouse, and I didn't feel like it was very developed, but in the grand scheme of things, it's probably the way it had to be. I still wish that I could have seen more.
Precisely, and that pretty much sums that part up for me as well. I love when they're at the, you know, secret meeting in the giant auditorium, and Bob's just standing there wearing his Secret Service sunglasses.
Yes. So unnecessarily. I mean, it makes no sense.
Yeah. I mean, like, it's clearly to be, like, you know, he's there to protect her, so why not have him be Secret Service?
Exactly.
And she reboots herself to a nice dress, which I thought was pretty neat. You don't see that a lot outside of games.
That's true. I never thought about that. But yeah, she's outside of a game and she rebooted into something differently. You're right. That was pretty interesting.
So,
Yeah, I thought it was hilarious how they were having a secret meeting with every binome in Sector 1000, and somehow they thought that they could get away with not getting caught.
Well, they would have gotten away with it if Cyrus hadn't been evil.
Well, that's true. That's true. But if Cyrus wasn't there, period, what would they have done?
Because precisely.
They should have had an exit plan or something.
Yeah.
As this was supposed to be. But I thought Cyrus did a pretty good job. He was very convincing, I think, on their team. I realized it a little earlier than what they said, but, you know, up until the point where the IDs, the PIDs were stolen, I thought Cyrus was a good guy.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned the PIDs, because this is really the first time we've mentioned them and what they do.
True.
And, you know, they're apparently like a social security number in that you can register it, and that's what helps them to be who they are. And if Megabyte corrupts them, then they become corrupted files and evil, as we see in Dot's vision.
Yeah. I mean, it is like social security cards and everything, except, you know, it controls your entire body. So it's kind of a big deal.
Yeah. So Sector 1000 is binary for 8. I don't know if that means anything, but it, you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's weird. Hmm. In Ott's visions, I guess you could call them, we see at one point where Frisket is captured and leading on a leash. And, you know, that's the point where I realized that life was bad when Frisket is down. That at that point, you're like, you know, everything's out the window.
Yeah.
There's no coming back if Frisk gets out.
I don't think he would have been, you know, okay with some guy leading him around on a leash. I think he would have raised some havoc and caused some major problems with that. I don't think he would have laid down so easily.
No, I don't think so either. Did you catch the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle reference?
Yes, sir. When they're racing through the tunnels, and Bob's like,
"Cowabunga!"
It's fantastic.
I love it because I was huge Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle reference, so I got that one immediately. And then, again, it's just one of those things Reboot does so well. Mm-hmm. There was, did you see the graffiti? As Dot was entering the secret meeting on the wall.
Right.
There was a couple of them. My favorite one was Smash the Solid State.
Yeah.
That was a good one.
I feel like that happened before somewhere, but I couldn't remember where.
There was some on the Crimson Binome on that ship. What was, maybe
it,
that was it.
It wasn't in there. I think it was in our first episode, one of the first three of Reboot. I don't know. If anybody's listening and remembers, you guys should let us know by going to mainframechronicle.blogspot.com and leaving a comment, or emailing us at mainframechronicle@gmail.com.
Yeah, I'd be interested in knowing. But I think there was also Megabyte for Hex. Was that as well?
MB4 Hex, which I don't really know what that's supposed to be saying. At first I thought it was MB plus Hex, as kind of like a Megabyte and hexadecimal sitting in a tree kind of thing.
Sure. Oh, maybe. But I think it does say 4, and I didn't quite get it either.
I don't know.
And then
it's weird.
Binomes Unite, which, you know, is fun, but not as good as the other ones, I don't think.
And there's a game of tic-tac-toe. Because
well,
why not? Some other... another interesting thing in is when we first see Dot, she's got all her vid windows open doing some work, and one of them has at the bottom of the screen it pops up and says Dot's binary dictionary, and it displays 0 is a noun less than 1, and then 1 noun more than 0. It's just, you know, subtle and interesting and pointless, but fun.
I did not see that at all. Did you notice a costume that Dot rebooted into when she was in the funhouse?
Yeah, it was like a Harley Quinn or something.
Yeah, which I didn't get it until I looked at it again. But yeah, it was supposed to be a nod to Harley Quinn, which I thought was cool. You know, one of the sexiest clowns ever to live.
No, of course.
And then the only other reference that I thought was worth mentioning was when Bob was checking his ABC's navigation screen, the text "Don't Panic" was briefly shown. Yes. Which I'm assuming you have read Douglas Adams.
It seems like
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And I love that series. And so Don't Panic was awesome.
Yeah. Fantastic.
Did you ever read any Terry Pratchett books?
I've read a couple. And they're fantastic.
Yeah, they're basically along the same satirical style as The Hitchhiker's Guide. So I always recommend them as well.
Yeah, so some quotes we have from these episodes. Fong is like, "We haven't converted one of Megabyte's sectors since... ever." I thought it was very well done. The pause was just perfect for the performance. And
exactly.
It's great that they, you know, haven't done that before. So...
I love that we had a couple good Fong things this episode, because at one point, you know, Dot talks about how lucky she is and how, you know, it was just a chance that it all worked out. And it was like, you know, chance has nothing to do with a child. The future is not determined by a throw of dice, but by the conscious decisions of you and me.
Yeah.
You know, just love how dramatic that guy is.
And it was perfect because, you know, this was during Dot's visions when Fong is living in a cardboard box and, you know, acting all sorts of crazy. And then he comes out with this, you know, very deep, thoughtful line and then instantly goes back to being crazy.
Now, was Fong crazy and thinking that Bob was that null? Or was Bob really that null?
That's a good question. I don't think Fong was crazy at all. I think it was similar to Enzo the Smart, where he was just acting the part so to teach the lesson that needed to be taught.
I'm pretty much going to give Fong the benefit of the doubt every single time, so I'm going to agree with you on that.
Yeah. It seems to me that he is always aware of what's going on and just kind of throws his hand out here and there. Similar to like someone like the Phantom Stranger from DC Comics, who's, you know, they're watching, and when they're absolutely needed, they'll pop up.
You know, that's kind of a good segue into just kind of a thought process that I was thinking while I was watching, you know, Fong, in terms of how he is aware and knowledgeable about everything. You know, I was thinking along the lines of like Dumbledore and how he was like super aware of everything going on, and yet somehow he allows the Chamber of Secrets to happen while he's down there. And, you know, the Triwizard Tournament, and one of his best friends was impersonated for months, at almost a year, and he didn't know it. And it's just, you know, you wonder, when you have such amazing characters like Fong and Dumbledore who are supposed to know everything, how does it always come down to other characters barely succeeding in saving the day?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's funny when that stuff works out like that.
Well, in the case of Dumbledore, and I always get a lot of flack for this, Dumbledore was pulling the strings the entire time. So really, he's the one that killed Voldemort, just using Harry Potter as the tool.
No, I completely agree. And I mean, if you look at it, Dumbledore was basically raising this kid for slaughter. Mm-hmm. And there was just a small chance that it was going to work out. And, you know, who do you really want to be? Do you want to be the person that's able to be, you know, smart and intelligent and think their way through a solution, but not ultimately succeed because you don't have the right heart or you seek power too much? Or do you want to be the person that, you know, can accomplish these things because they have the heart and soul, but not necessarily the desire? And I think that kind of comes down a lot to almost relevant to everyday life and what kind of person you want to be.
Right.
I think about it probably too much, honestly. Do you have any other references or anything that you want to talk about this episode?
The only other thing I have is we get the first appearance of Binky and Algernon, who are the two guys flying a plane in the game at the beginning of part one.
I forgot about that. The two British binomes.
Yeah, they don't really ever do anything, but they're there for a comedy moment when things are about to go bad.
Now, I wanted to bring this up to you. If you listen to the first episode, Dan and I met while we were roommates in Australia. And when we were in Australia, our third roommate was British, and his name's Michael. And while this guy was going off, all these British binomes were talking, they said jolly good. Now, Michael swears to me that British people do not say jolly good and chip chap cheerio and all that good chit chat. I'm telling you, Reboot taught me this. So it's not my fault that I didn't know that. British people don't really say jolly good.
That's a fair assessment.
I'm going to bring that up to him next
time.
Blame
the Canadians. They ruined it.
Exactly. They ruined things. I don't know if I can really get behind that. But
no, they don't. They don't ruin much of anything. Except for the Bieber.
Well, that's different.
Canadians as a whole don't ruin everything.
No. No, probably. It's because they don't get involved in a whole lot, really.
Exactly.
They try to stay out of it. But did you see that after Dot is captured and barcoded and her hair's all shaved and she looks in the mirror, there was some graffiti on the left side of the mirror. And I tried to like pause and read what it said, and I couldn't figure it out. I had to do some research, and it says final shot of season one. Which I'm guessing then would be that's the last one that they like tweaked, you know, to be ready to go. Because it's obviously not the final actual scene of season one.
Yeah, it was the last scene rendered is what I've been told.
Oh, okay, that makes sense then.
Go for it.
Oh, we've talked about this before too. When Megabyte was trying to de-encrypt or to break the code or the encryption of Dot's Palm Pilot, which that's something to talk about too. Just in the '90s, who says Palm Pilot anymore? Really?
Yeah, no kidding.
I kind of flashback to the '90s there, but her code is Guardian. Now, what do you think that means?
Definitely not that she's in love with Bob, because that would be silly.
No. And the only reason she got jealous of Mouse is because Mouse had to save the day. It has nothing to do with the fact that her and Bob have a history.
Right. Nothing of the sort.
No one believes me. But truly, Bob here used to be a great guardian. He was something back then. But those times are gone. Cute little fellow, no?
No, that's not Bob. It can't be. Oh, what have I done? I lost the game and I destroyed Mainframe. I didn't even try. If only I could have another chance.
Chance has nothing to do with it, child. The future is not determined by a throw of the dice. It is determined by the conscious decisions of you and me.
What? What did you say?
Oh, would you like to see my windshield collection? I have many kinds.
So, Dan, what did you think of this episode?
Overall, it was pretty good. I think as a whole, both of them together, it's a lot stronger. So, yeah, I'm going to have to give it about probably an 8 or 8.5. I'm going to go with an 8.5. Converted sectors.
That'll work. Yeah, I thought about that too. It is definitely better when you think of this whole episode as part one and two. And, you know, looking back as we're watching this episode by episode, it's interesting how, I wonder what I would have thought when I just watched the first part of this, because I watched them back to back, and I think it would be different. But I'm going to give it probably just a solid 8 unnecessary aviators.
Nice. That's
what I'm going to say. So, yeah, overall, I thought it was good. I, you know, it did propel the story forward. And I also think it was interesting how we're kind of now getting into the idea where each episode is not a beginning, a middle, and end, and it's kind of going to be a little bit more of a story arc, and you'll just see that progress more and more as the series continues. So, and yeah. I like that. So,
yeah, and it'll take us to some better stories with higher stakes, and it's just all around a good thing.
I completely agree.
So, yeah, that pretty much does it for season one. We're going to do a little bit of a recap here now, so bear with us while we do that.
Farm, we're collecting their numbers now.
Excellent. Why, we haven't converted one of Megabyte's sectors since... never. I'll prepare the operating system for the additional PIDs right now.
Joey, what would you say your favorite episode was of the season?
You know, it's hard looking back because there was a couple of good ones and you want to give them all credence, but I'm just going to go with my favorite single episode is going to be The Talent Night. I just really love that episode.
Awesome.
What about you, Dan?
I'm going to have to disagree with you and say Talent Night was not the best episode, but that Crimson Binome was. And while my scores don't necessarily reflect that, I think I gave this last one, Identity Crisis, a higher score than Crimson Binome. I still think that Crimson Binome was a better one, so I'm probably going to change my score from Crimson Binome up to a 9 to reflect that.
Well, Dan, what do you think was your least favorite episode?
Least favorite would have to be, which one was it? Enzo the Smart was definitely the low end for me. It was just boring and boring and boring.
Yeah, I didn't really care for that one either. But when I was thinking back to what I didn't like, maybe we should go with Enzo the Smart, but I settled on the Tiff. Just because it was so cliche. And, you know, we've talked about a couple times how, you know, it's awesome when you take an old story and then twist it all around and create something new with ReBoot. And this was an old story. I just didn't care for it at all. I kind of, you know, nodded off. I had to focus on writing notes. So, and most episodes I didn't have to do that. So I'm going to go with the Tiff as my least favorite.
Fair enough.
And then I think the next thing we'll move into is the different characters. And I think what we'll do is we'll split it up into two different categories, like our best main cast characters and then our best and worst main cast characters and then best and worst of the secondary cast characters. And this will include any one-time appearances of people, which I think there's very few one-time appearances because for the most part, they do show back up again somewhere else in the series. But so we're going to break that up into two categories. And Dan, what would be your favorite main character?
Favorite main character in this season would have to be Enzo, I think.
And why do you say that?
He's just, you know, fun all the time. He's still young and foolish and learning things. But, you know, Bob's just too generic and to goody two shoes hero, and Dot's not very interesting yet to me. So I'm gonna have to go with Enzo.
I can agree with you on that. I think I'm gonna go with Dot though, only because when we saw Enzo in the first episode, he was basically the same Enzo on the end of first season. Not a whole lot had changed, and that's the same for Bob. Whereas Dot, her character probably developed, I think, a little bit more than the other ones. You know, because you knew that she was hardcore and she was, you know, a tough 90s chick. But then you learn that she owns half of Mainframe. And then you learn that she can change the Crimson Binome's plans and then go into business with him. And that she can also inspire people of Sector 1100 to rebel against Megabyte. You know, so she did a cool, you know, she kind of just got bigger and bigger, I think.
Fair enough.
So I'm going to go with Dot.
Makes sense.
Then what about your least favorite character?
Least favorite. Huh. that's a tough one because, you know, they're all pretty good in their own rights. Just some are better than others. I'm going to have to go with Hexadecimal because even though she's not really a main character in this one, that's pretty much why, is that we don't see enough of her. So
I can agree with that. I go all sorts of crazy for Hexadecimal, so I can get behind that. When I was thinking least favorite characters, I'm honestly going to have to go with Bob. And I hate to say that because I like them all, and they all really fill their own niches. But he didn't really do a whole lot of development at all this series. He's great for some awesome lines and stuff, so I'm all about that. But he didn't really mesh with me as an all-time amazing kind of candidate for that kind of stuff. So
fair enough.
I guess we can move into secondary characters then, and this will include any guest stars, anything like that. So what would be your favorite, Dan?
Favorite? Oh man, there's so many. I love Hack and Slash. They're fun. Their banter is hilarious. I love Cecil. His snootiness is off the charts. And I just got a phone call. But I think I'm going to have to go with Mouse, even though we only see her once. I'm excited to see more of her. Actually, no, I'll take that back. I'm going to go with Captain Gavin Capacitor, the Crimson Binome.
Yeah, you took mine. I was all about...
He's fantastic.
He is so funny, and everything he did was perfect, and again, anything he touched was gold. So I'm going to have to agree with you on... I was between him and Frisket. That was what I was
yes,
going.
Ah, yes, Frisket. I think a three-way tie between those three.
Frisket, yeah, I can do that. I can agree
Captain
with that.
Captain Capacitor and Mouse. So...
And then your least favorite?
Least favorite. Definitely not Toot Guy, because he's definitely awesome.
He was in the last one, too. I forgot to mention it, but I saw a sighting of Toot Guy.
Good, good. Yeah, he hides in, you know, jukeboxes and goes down energy slides and gets front row at rock concerts. So he's pretty awesome.
Exactly. I don't know what the guy does on a day-to-day basis, but...
Yeah. I'm going to go with Scuzzy. Mouse's cat-like thing, because...
You mean Hexadecimal's?
Yeah, Hexadecimal's cat-like thing that's just boring and doesn't do much.
It's hard to choose, because there's a whole lot of cool stuff and a whole lot of good characters. Scuzzy, that was a good one, but I don't want to take that one as well. I hadn't decided. I thought maybe while we were going through everything, I might be able to actually decide my least favorite character or secondary character. And I never was able to.
Yeah, it's tough.
I guess, you know, I'm going to go with Emma C, just because her voice was really annoying. She was the censor, thank you. Yeah, that was kind of mocking ABC and their censorship. Her voice was very annoying, so I'm going to go with her as my least favorite.
True story. So we decided we're going to average out the scores, and that'll be the score for the season. And so due to mine, added them up, divided it by 12 because we counted the last two as one episode. So there's technically 12 episodes in the season. And I came out with an average of 6.7.
And I was just a little higher than Dan. I came out as a solid 7.
So, yeah, that is pretty accurate. If I were to rate the season on its own without averaging out, I'd say it's probably a 7.5 or an 8. Just because it's a solid intro to the show, so...
Exactly, and there's room to grow, and that's the point I think that I would like to make with season one, is there's a crap ton of room to grow, so that's what I'm excited about.
And the show does grow. It grows fantastically.
Absolutely. So,
yeah, that'll do it for season one, and that'll do it for episodes for the year of 2012. Next time you guys hear us, it'll be 2013. So
that is if the world doesn't end. We got to take that into account.
Yeah, that's always a possibility. So
thank you, as always, for that. Email us at mainframechronicle@gmail.com. We'd love to hear some feedback on how we're doing. We want to make this the best for you guys. So, because it's fun for us to just rewatch it, and you know, we want to make this a good companion podcast to listen to as you're rewatching it. So, you know, please send us your feedback.
Yeah, we did things a little differently today with the shorter reviews, a little bit of a one-line summary instead of a small paragraph. So let us know if that works better for you guys or not. Again, you can do that via email at mainframechronicle@gmail.com. You could comment on our blog posts at mainframechronicle.blogspot.com. You can find us on Facebook by searching Mainframe Chronicle, or you can find us on Twitter at twitter.com/MFChronicle.
And as always, stay frosty, my friends.
I'm going to plug a few more things. We have other podcasts. I have other podcasts if you want to listen to them. Check out Rogue Arrow or Cinemasters. You can find both of those and links on the Blogspot page. Or you can find a link to my personal blog, which is fun and exciting. You can also follow me on Twitter at AmazingBass. That's BASS.
And I guess you can follow me on Twitter, too. I just got one, so it's probably not going to be all that good yet. It is at BabyKangaroo90. My name's Joey. I'm not weird.
Awesome. That's a clever name, since your name is Joey, and Joey is the name for Baby Kangaroo.
Thank you for clarifying.
In case anyone missed that. So, yeah, thanks for listening so far. Hope you guys have been enjoying it.
We sure have.
Until next time.
Until next time. Stay frosty, my friends.
Wanted to do that.
Happy birthday, Enzo.
Ladies and gentlemen, Megabyte has left the building. We'll be right back.
Archer, the battling bowman, Ollie, whatever name you know him by, he is best known as Oliver Queen, the billionaire playboy who was stranded on an island for 5 years, forcing him to become the Arrow. Join us as we follow his journey to clean up the mess his father helped create in Starling City. I am Daniel Janes.
I'm Chris O'Neill.
I'm Laurel Murs.
And I'm Rudy Schubach.
And you should check out Rogue Arrow Podcast, where we talk about the CW show Arrow. You can find us at roguearrow.blogspot.com or by searching iTunes or Facebook for Rogue Arrow Podcast. The movie game is a game that Rudy and I play where we come up with a starting point and an ending point, and we try to get there using the same rules as 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon, essentially.
More often than not, it just sort of devolves into a vehicle for which you talk about awesome movies. But yeah, that's sort of the bare bone structure from the way I play it.
Yes. So, Rudy, what are we going to be starting off with?
We're starting with Drive.
So we're going from Drive to Goldfinger. We're going to connect them somehow. Do you want to start or do you want me to start?
I'll say we got the movie Drive. We're going to Ryan Gosling just because he's the only one who is in it, I guess.
Exactly. Okay, Ryan Gosling was also in The Notebook.
Who's in that? Rachel McAdams.
Rachel McAdams, another name I don't know. So maybe Drive is not the best place.
Oh no, I got this one. Okay, Rachel McAdams was in Wedding Crashers.
Wedding Crashers, awesome. That's Vince Vaughn and Owen Wilson. I think I'll go Vince Vaughn. I feel like he's more connected.
Let's go Vince Vaughn to his early work, Swingers.
We'll go Jon Favreau.
So let's go with Jon Favreau to, he was in a bunch of movies recently. He was in I Love You Man.
Pretty much all the Marvel movies.
He was in specifically Iron Man. And in Iron Man there was, can we go through
Iron Man and Iron Man 2?
Yeah, so either of the, we can go through either of the guys who played Colonel James Rhodes, or we can go through Robert Downey was in Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. With Val Kilmer?
Yeah.
Val Kilmer was in...
Val Kilmer was in Batman Forever.
Which was
Tommy Lee Jones and Jim Carrey.
Tommy Lee Jones. He's got to have been in a movie that we can go through. A lot of people give us crap because they're like, you should be trying to find the shortest route. And it's like, that's not the point.
No, no. I mean, this isn't a great example because we're not stopping and talking about all the movies. But that's what we normally do, and that's usually what this game is played for.
Okay, so we got Tommy Lee Jones. We're going to go Tommy Lee Jones to, what was he? He was in something less modern. We got to start moving backwards. He was in The Fugitive.
Harrison Ford.
Well, that'll get us to Harrison Ford, exactly. Harrison Ford's an older actor, which means he'll be in movies closer to that time period.
Harrison Ford. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade.
Oh no! Yes, you're right. He played Indy's father, and there you go. Harrison Ford to Sean Connery through Last Crusade to James Bond, Goldfinger.
Bam! Awesome. Well.
Anyway, so that's an example of the movie game. Yay! We made it.
If you like what you just heard, or if you like movies, or if you just like us, check out Cinemasters, a new movie review podcast coming soon.